Eric, public comment if we're right now, wait.
I would wait.
Okay.
Cause you have to read it again.
All right, calling me in order, 5:07. The, any public comment on closed session items? Okay, I'm there. For closed session, we're gonna be talking about a 2A, public employee appointment, certificated classified, pursuant to building code 54957. Item two. Point two. Public employee discipline dismissal release pursuant to government code 54947. Item 2.3, conference with labor negotiator pursuant to government code 54957.9. Negotiator Molly and Barnes, employees organizations, Sunol AFT, chapter 1494 local, CSA chapter 862, and management classified employees. And item 2.4, public employee performance evaluation superintendent, and we'll leave for closed session.
You hear them today?
Call the meeting is in public order, it's 6:07, we start with pledge allegiance. What do you? All right, thanks, welcome everybody, we got a real diverse crowd here, we got a lot of business to take care of, so I'm gonna start out with reading our public comment information. Oh, and also please make sure your cell phones are all muted if you haven't done that already. The governing board encourages public discussion of all items on the agenda. Anyone wishing to address the board may submit a comment form prior to the start of the agenda item discussion. So I have three so far, if anybody else needs a phone more. Comment forms will not be accepted for any items once the item has been announced. A person wishing to address the board shall first be recognized by the president and shall then proceed to comment as briefly as the subject permits. There's a 3-minute maximum speaking time per person on a single agenda item. The limit on discussing each item is 20 minutes. Board bylaw 9323 states the board cannot comment on a non-agenda item. However, the matter may be placed on the agenda of a subsequent meeting for action or discussion by the board or the Brown Act. And please be advised our meeting is being recorded. Thank you. Number four is action on closed session. Oh, curious. The board approved the following personnel items. Certificated employees, one fifth grade teacher returned from leave to 0.5 FTE, and one occupational therapist, independent contractor. And that's all this looks at. Next item is number five, approval of the agenda. Make a motion to approve the agenda with the following changes. Just want to move item 8A. All right, thank you. Item 8A and 10B up just before number six.
I second.
Any discussion?
Yeah.
Okay, on paper?
Aye.
Okay, Jen's approved. Let's move right to 8A, and that is Citizens for a Healthy Alameda County Environment report and presentation by Jerry B.
Okay.
Thank you.
Well, here I am back after 12 years of.
And with a good reason.
Yeah, well, So we in the Andrade Sheridan Road group fought real hard. I don't remember how many years, it seems like it was 10 years ago. When they wanted to put a composting facility right next to the driving range. And it was called Stop the Dump. And Kaz and Mike Kaz, who's since passed, myself, Lori Brooks, Linda Pappas, all of us pitched in a whole bunch of money to try to fight that thing. And we prevailed with the help of Sunol and Pat Stillman and a lot of other people. We kept the composting facility from there. It would have been a kind of smelly neighbor So thank God they're not there. Anyhow, we raised a bunch of money. I don't remember how much at the time. It was all partly checks that I wrote, Kaz wrote, everybody on Sheridan Road and Andrade, John Franco. It must have been $10,000 or $15,000, and we didn't spend it all. So Gil, before he was leaving town, he's moved up and retired up in the foothills, said, we got to do something with that money. What do you want to do? And I voted, I said, let's give it to the school. Gil voted, let's give it to the school. And so at any rate, so I come here today with $7,724.11. And here we go. It's all for the school.
Excellent. It's a photo op.
Or my hat, just in case. These are both my neighbors. I don't think you were there when we did that. Neither of you.
But they put a support.
This is none of your money.
They can't talk plain. They can't. I didn't hear.
You were born there. No, not really. It's unlimited. You can do with it as you choose.
Excellent. Yes. You want to hold it like with your hand to get over? No, it's mine.
No.
You got to look right here. I count on three. 1, 2, 3. One this way. One more time. 1, 2, 3. Gotcha.
Well, I do see. I do see Cheryl. To tell you.
Spend it wisely. Hang on.
On my turn. Sorry. I will say I see Cheryl in the audience, and I think she perked up when you said compost, because we're always looking for funds to go to our beautiful garden, which is part of the curriculum for students. So, and they put out a sink out there. There's a labyrinth. There's a willow dome. Every year they have a different project that they've enhanced. And so I'm not making any promises, but
we're all for composting, not 100,000 yards in our backyard. That's all.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm going to stay for a little bit because it sounds like it might get exciting.
Thank you, Mr. B. Miller. This is an unexpected, wonderful donation and quite a lot. Awesome. So thank you.
Thank you very much.
Where's Teresa? Oh, wait.
Okay, now we're moving item 10B up, which is report discussion of possible action to approve resolution number 22-2023-10 in recognition of dedicated service presented to Teresa Donadel.
Oh. So the staff's recommendation to the board is to not approve.
That's it.
Yeah, absolutely. You have to say. So this is the resolution that we wrote for Ms. Donovan to honor her. So Teresa Donovan, whereas the Sonoplan Unified School District Board of Trustees, students, staff, and community recognize and appreciate the dedicated services of Teresa Donovan. I think you can just be up here. Yeah. I want to be by myself. You can. I have a teaching. Okay. Now I have to start over. She said no. Okay, awesome. Whereas Teresa Donovan has served as an outstanding fiscal service clerk in the Sonoplan Unified School District since 1996, providing support in conflict resolution, yard duty, student council advisory, and a myriad of other tasks, and is extremely dedicated to the staff and to the school. And whereas Teresa Donovan provided sound fiduciary oversight and support that supports our staff in making recommendations with the best interests of our students, always, always in her heart. And whereas Teresa Donovan has created collegial relationships with the Alameda County Office of Education, representing Sonoplan, which directly impacts successful budgetary decisions. And whereas Teresa Donovan embodies professionalism with her can-do attitude, exceptional ability with systems and logistics, her amazing work ethic of work till it's done philosophy, and whereas Sonoplan is fortunate to have Teresa Donovan, who is dedicated, hardworking, and loyal, and truly cares about providing an optimal learning experience for our students, and has been a part of the Eagle family for the past 31 years. And now therefore be it resolved that Sonoplan Unified School District is very grateful and appreciative of Teresa Donovan's amazing service and her devotion to kids, and that the Board of Trustees hereby recognizes Teresa Donovan for her outstanding service for Sonoplan Unified School District. Maybe pass some Anyway, it has been amazing. I just want to give a really quick little story that this is the beauty of Teresa and her systems thinking. Something will be not quite going right, and she just has this uncanny ability to be like, you know what we ought to do is, and so we have to do these universal lunch programs now that we went from feeding 25 kids lunch every day to 140 kids lunch every day. That's a huge difference. And so it has to be systematized. And she came up with this idea of using pocket charts that are using classrooms, how the kids have their tickets, which makes the kid, well, especially the kindergarten or the first graders, they feel so proud. Like, I'm going to get my own little ticket. They feel very independent. It's out there outside, so it doesn't block the line. And it has made our lunch, it goes by. These kids want to eat because they don't really want to eat. They want to go play. So that is just a little example, but those kind of tweaks make our school run very smooth. And there's all those systems in there. And like I said, the relationship with the county is key for this position. And she works really hard to make sure that it's a seamless conversation and that also therefore all the decisions we make is run through that sort of chain of command, because obviously the county has to approve our board, our budget every, not our board, they don't get a say, our budget every year. And so just really appreciative. And she swears that we're still on speed dial.
Bessie called me.
She said she wasn't going to block our numbers. So anyway, we have these beautiful blocks. We had our party last week, and I didn't bring my poem, but I wrote a really cool
poem. Congratulations.
Motion to approve the.
No.
Okay. Sorry. Motion to approve the resolution.
I second.
Any discussion?
Yes.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All right.
Now you can think.
Okay. We need y'all again.
Yeah. Now, let's get the report. Get the woman of the hour. You got the middle. There you go.
Katie and Mary, can you come up to me and get a picture of our meeting?
Oh.
One, two, three, four. So this little one is why she's been here 31 years. Okay, on three, one, two, three, one more. One, two,
three. There you go. Are you gonna let your mom answer their phone? Thank you so much. Of course, it was beautiful the other day. Did you like how I had the coral on the font?
I did. I like that.
Yeah,
there's
like educated, but they had a good coral on the font. They know how to do it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, and thank you to all the family. You know, the family has to support somebody to work that hard and to be available. So I just appreciate the family as well.
Yes, please.
No phone call.
Donovan family, you're also welcome to stay or leave, whatever. Item six is approval of content of the Level 1 Developer Fee Study for Snow Glen Unified School District.
It's pretty long. We presented it back in August. But we just needed to do the formality one more time to make sure we cross our T's and dotted our I's. And so there it is. I know everybody had a chance to look at it on the agenda online. Then you can open it for public.
Okay, we can open up. Item number seven.
Oh, sorry. Sorry, I'm jumping. Prove it.
Okay. Motion to approve the developer fee study.
I second.
Any discussion?
Mm-hmm.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, now, thank you. One word. So, seven, public hearing, school developer fees increase. And I make a motion to approve.
So the public fee. Hearing is so that the public has an opportunity to say anything if they want to about it.
All right. And we didn't get any ones, so go ahead and close the public hearings.
You feel free?
I guess we already. All right. Number eight, board and staff reports, communications. 8B is enrollment report.
So our enrollment's holding steady. We're still declining enrollment from where we were pre-pandemic. Kindergarten across the state of California has lagged significantly. We used to have those classes running at about 23 to 1. They're all at 18 to 1, which is nice, but that's a lot of loss. But this is, they're seeing this across the state. They're thinking that because kindergarten is not compulsory, that parents with still that sort of residual fear of the pandemic, they're still choosing to keep their children home. So kind of interesting. But right now we're at 270.
HC superintendent's report.
I get to talk again. All right. So I just have a couple of, we have a couple of thank yous. We had our amazing annual walkathon, which again, what we're seeing is how the COVID-19 pandemic, the shutdown, really threw a lot of our beloved events out the window, actually. And then why we always feared that is we know that when something, you don't do something, you lose the momentum of it. Mm-hmm. It takes an inordinate amount of work for our volunteers and our staff to put these kinds of things together. And then you kind of lose the memory of it as well. Luckily, our community club has always been uber organized. And one of the gifts that was created, I don't even know, 15 years ago or something, was these binders that kind of were, or sorry, Cammy, IT, Google Docs, that kind of contain a step-by-step with the idea that as new people come in, we want them to feel very comfortable filling those shoes. And they knocked it out of the park. So this was the first year out of 3 years that we allowed parents on campus to enjoy that event with us, which was something really hard to not have, because what makes Sentinel Glen, one of the many things that makes Sentinel Glen so special, is the amount of parent and staff and students interaction. And to not, remember last year, I think we had the parents at the, it was like we were in the zoo. The parents were at the zoo looking in and they weren't allowed to. I mean, it was hard. And then the 2 years ago, kids were at home. So we didn't even have, we did try to a little virtual thingy. This was full out. The kids did the laps. Parents were there. The parents ran the stations. We weren't sure about the fire, having the fire, Alameda County Fire Department come. So Kelly Guerra, thank you. She contacted them. They were on it. It's a really beloved event for them. They actually walk the walk and they let their favorite thing is to let the kids squirt them with water. They're such good sports. Maybe it feels better than their fire hose because it's a little weak ones. And the kids feel so honored to be able to do that. So it's just a win-win. And then they were so nice. We didn't ask them to turn on the fire hose because we just didn't want to ask that. But they look forward to it. And they're like, we want to turn on the fire hose. And okay. So the kids, a fireman's fire hose on the kids. So it was just a spectacular event. We sang the school song. We had staff members that were nicely volunteered to go up and do something silly that the kids liked that as well. So it was phenomenal. We have a much lower enrollment than we've had in the past. And yet we had the highest participation rate ever. I think it was 91. I won't report this too, sorry, it'll be redundant. 91% participated. And with 270 students, our little school raised 42. They reach out to businesses and they have great ways of doing it, but about $42,000 go into our parents club fund, and the parents club uses those funds to do things like the garden and filter. It goes right back to the students, right back to the classroom. So that's amazing. That just floored me. So well done and thank you. There's a huge list. I did put it in the Eagle flyer because there's so many people to thank, but just so it's on record, I do want to really quickly read their names. I won't say what they did, but Rebecca LeGates, Teresa Lee, Paula Jenkins, Helen Tan, Kay Wagner, Trudy Shruma, Veronica Doherty, Jennifer Lawrence, Trisha Young, AJ Barajwa, Hillary Young, Heather Gilfillan, Ruti Rathor, Serena Luker-Bowden, Kelly Guerra, Angela Chow, Peking Yang, Annie Bonnerson, Sandy Chan, and again, our sponsor, our coordinator was Cheryl Thompson, who just worked tirelessly. I think you were just sweating and running around. I do want to give a shout out to those brave souls that are willing to be silly in front of the kids and who joined me. I had to do it too. Chris Wheeler in the house. Aurora Comments, Kerouac Diamond, new to our school. He used to be a student here and now he's working here because we come find him. And then we make him volunteer. Kinderman Dahl, Sean Gabel, Carly Horton, Nancy Chipperich, Rachel Mildry, Linda Yen, Keely Garcia, and Marita Duvall. So it was just a gorgeous community event and lots of fun, and raised a lot of money for our school. So that's amazing. Speaking of fun events, because we do schooling here, but there's a lot of fun events. Halloween Parade, another event that got put on the back burner for 2 years. Last year we had it. The Alameda County Sheriff's Department and the Alameda County Cal Fire are so generous about kicking off our parade. And the Sinole Business Guild is always an important partnership in making the kids feel so special. But if you're not doing anything on October 31st, I know you'll be all ready for your own trick-or-treaters, please come downtown, because it is a super fun event. The town actually shuts down Main Street. I love when we have new teachers here, they can't believe it. They're like, wait, the town shuts down Main Street and we get a walk on Main Street? I go, yeah. And then the training guys usually come, and then they dress up and they wave at the kids. It's just a real community experience. And so we will parade down at about 11, we'll line up at 11:15. So the fire truck and the police will lead it off. So make sure everything is safe. And then we walk down Main Street, and the kids love having people looking at them and waving at them. So if you aren't doing anything, please come on down and support and wave at the kids. And we walk down, and then we head through the park, and then the band is playing as they're going through, and then we come back home. So we encourage you to come. Super fun, really cute. Parent conferences. Back to academics. They're coming up November 21st through 25th. Really, another real excitement. We've been doing those virtually. This will be the first year that we're going to allow parents have the option. The teachers are going to block off time that are for those parents that would prefer virtual. And then they're going to block off times for those parents that really are just eager to come into the classroom. It has been amazing. Like, we'll have parents, now that we're more opened up, that have been here for 2 years or even three, and they walk in like, I've never had a chance to be in school before. And that's so different from us. I mean, we always were run over by parents. And so it's just been wonderful, very heartwarming to kind of get back to where we need to be. And we have another amazing family that they do want to be anonymous, so we won't say their name, but they generously donated a pretty pricey piece of PE equipment or recess equipment. It's called the Gaga Pit to play Gaga Ball. Never heard of it. So of course I had to Google it. It looks amazing. Oh, there it is. So it's being built as we speak. And it's, how do I explain it? It's a little bit dodgeball-y, but you climb in and you can only kick these little soft rubber balls, and it's controlled, like only so many kids in at a time. And if you get kicked by the ball, then you have to pop out and somebody else can, kind of like Foursquare, where then somebody else can go in. But the kid, you could see they're like, let us in, but it's not done. The bolts aren't tightened yet. So we have a little sign in the middle that says, do not enter. The company was great. They asked for our school colors. They asked for our emblems. So on one of the sides, it has the Sinole Glen Eagle. And again, they're not inexpensive. And so a wonderful family paid for that and donated it to our school. Just have another fun, you can see the slack line is right there. That's where kids practice balance. So we have, and then we got last year or 2 years ago that paid for the yardscape, and I think there's like 10 exercise stations for circuit training, and those are around that back area too. So yeah, that has really come a long way. So anyway, that is my report. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. 8D is bond update, and we have some forms filled out. If people want to speak. Just going to go with the first one I got, and Paul Montiaro.
How does it work? Is it question answered or is it?
You have 3 minutes to talk. If you ask questions, I'll write them down.
You better be a stenographer.
It's also recorded. So
this is for one of my neighbors, but I'll start off with this one.
Okay.
When did the seismic retrofit of $3.1 million, the largest single cost item, become known to the board? Why wasn't it included in the description of items to be dealt with in the actual bond measure language? That was number one. And then why wasn't the seismic retrofit an issue during Measure O? Didn't it exist then? And then what physical investigation has been done to determine the buildings have not been retrofitted? Because we're under the assumption that it was done in 1999. And then also, if it is unsafe, how come there's children in it? And I was here for four meetings in a row, and the that was never brought up, seismic issue, the last four board meetings.
Is that?
I don't know if that was 3 minutes, but that's a lot for you to write down.
I think so. We have someone timing, so if you have any comments.
There's 1 minute and 50 seconds left.
And then also, where is the math and lab, math and science lab being built? Is that in a lot of the website, school website, it's not shown, but then you find it deep down in the bond measure that they've been going to construct. That sounds to me like there's going to be a new building being built. I don't know if construct means build, not retrofit, but you use that term on a different, on the multi-purpose room, use retrofit or rebuild. So that one says construct. So that's just one of the question, one last question.
Okay. Thanks for questions. And I guess
after the master,
I could say that some of those, those are good questions. And the seismic, our architect was hired to make recommendations. And it is including what work has already been done and what is recommended from through the DSA and the state to also be careful of, because there's all these predictions about the big earthquakes coming. So it's another opportunity for us to go in and make sure the 1999 work is still relevant. Our 1925-year-old building is historic and beautiful. Personally, I always feel like older buildings were built really, really well. But to your point, we would hate for us to not have the availability of funds to do any fixes that then deem that building an unsafe place for children. Right now, we have had no fire marshal or anybody that has come forward and they look for all those things, and they would condemn it. But keeping children safe, that's why a lot of these projects are so pricey, is we have to go through the DSA. And that piece alone, this price tag goes up significantly because of the children, need to make sure that this is done in such a way to make sure kids are safe. The word construction versus, what did you say?
Rebuild.
There's no, and Bob, I'm gonna look you right in the eye because I remember exactly what you said to me. There is no new multi-purpose room being built. There is an opportunity for us to understand that the cafeteria was built in 1950. Those buildings or the portable buildings have, of course, Mr. Hoxie, the life, they're beyond their lifespan. And so we want to make sure that those buildings are up to speed where they need to be. We have ceiling tiles that are falling down. That's a safety issue.
How come they're not replaced?
They are. And so I'm just saying that the building was from 1950s. The science and math lab, the idea that the architect had was to make that what's called a flexible space. So looking at ways to better utilize our current facilities as they are with some different ways of setting them up. So that's what that would be in. There's, per the law, the bond has to have a citizens oversight committee. Are we out of time? So we looked up right now in the 2020 bond, it was listed as well. Okay,
that's it. Back to the, you had a quick thing about was any earthquake upgrades done in 1999? Mr. Hoxie, I think you can answer that. I think it was 1999 this wing was built, but I don't think they did seismic. Is that true? It was like in 1935 or something?
1939 is the last seismic.
1939 for the main. 1925.
All the original board members from 99 that are still alive, I asked them and they all said they remember being done. Okay. It was seismic work done.
I wasn't here.
Yeah, me neither.
We can't find any documents that say so. Doesn't mean it didn't happen, but I think in good conscience, we have to look out for the safety of our kids. So a lot of the bond measure issues are safety, security, with school shootings, those types.
No, absolutely. But it seems like it wasn't brought up for, like I said, for four previous board meetings, was never mentioned. And this, and then
the only when I asked for them, given.
I was here for four of them and it wasn't, they never talked about it.
Okay.
And then when I asked you for the price list, all of a sudden it popped up and it seemed like it was just a fill-in or something, to put in, to make it exactly $10.9 million. And something I found strange was all of those numbers that you gave me, you said it was New Architect, added up exactly to $10.9 million, which just found it. I just found it odd.
Their estimate.
It was down to the dollar.
It's bond capacity.
So that's why we asked for $10.9 million. He he'd come up with this list, and then we asked for that much. Our bond capacity is much higher. It's actually 12 million.
But per the feedback from the community that asked us not to do certain things, we took stuff out. We're lowering them out. And he is conservative. He's done this for years and years. And he knows that when you get in and you start doing something, you go on an estimation, and then you give a, you build in for contingencies or change orders or whatever. Right. And so that's how you get to that $2, right? So if he did, if we took that 20% out or whatever, it would be, I don't know, it's 20%, 8.5 million or whatever. But he purposely looked at, okay, that's the capacity. That's how we can also make sure that we build in for contingencies. Are we done?
Yeah.
Okay, sorry. We got your questions and we'll follow up.
Yeah, we'll definitely follow up.
And we just want to preserve this, our this gem of a school, and keep it safe and thrive for years and years for, you know, our grandkids to attend here. We just want to make it safe and preserve it. We're not. All right.
Thank you. I like good comments. Okay, Bob Perlman, you're next.
Hi. I came primarily to, I guess, put a face to the cabal that is supposed to be the No on J committee that doesn't exist. I'm one of the guys who still remains uncommitted to supporting it. I question, Ms. Barnes, we had meetings in your office with the architect. I questioned them. My big hang-up was a direct question to you guys. All right, you're asking at the time for $9 million. This was back at the old bond, yeah. I think it was, Measure O, when we met. I asked the question, do you, when the real bids come in, this is what the architect thought it was going to cost. And at the time, I think he had somewhere near $1 million for the roof, which around the table, I thought we came to a conclusion that it really should be like 350,000 or right. Something like that. I asked the question, okay, you're asking for $1 million. The bids come in and it's 500. Do you sell $500,000 worth of bonds? No, the answer was we will find something to spend the rest of it on. I have an issue with that. I got a real problem with that. If, you know, the I love this school as much as anybody in this room and don't want to see anything bad happen or have it fall apart, fall off the foundations. But I'll be darned if I can get my head wrapped around the idea that as a board, you just ask for a bucket of money and you just spend it till it's gone. If there are things, I mean, Measure O was on the plate a couple of years ago, as the way most things have always happened in Sunol. Where has the school been or the board been as far as community engagement, meetings? I mean, this is a community that took 2 years to figure out the ambient lighting of the streetlights out there on Main Street. So there's a real history of people wanting to get involved. And I remain firm with my statement that I made at the last time at our last meeting that if that occurred, you could get universal support from people if there was a real plan and it was presented in a way that people would buy into it, as opposed to, I think there's sort of a feeling out there that the bond issue came up last time, it went down, it didn't pass, and then the board went stealth, just everybody disappeared. And then just a month or so, a couple months ago, boom, here it comes back. Now, it's probably been going on for a lot longer than that, and I've been in my hole down the road down here. But it almost appears as if it just popped up again at a higher number. So give up the rest of my time there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So just to address some of those questions. I feel really bad that was it the architect that said that about we'll just find something else to spend the money on, because I personally disagree with that. You know, we are a board and we have to decide, but in my opinion, you know, we're asking the public to, you know, support us for 10.9 million to do all these projects we have. If the money that we are getting is not on the project list, we're not allowed to spend it on just anything else. As a matter of fact, you know, we wouldn't stop going out for grants, for fundraising, for anything. You know, like Jerry just brought in 7,000. What if we could, you know, put in new windows with that money. We could use that. And we won't sell all the bonds. You know, I think we have our bond professional guy back here, but we sell them in three different blocks. So we'll sell the first block, second block. If we get to the third block and we don't need the money, let's say, like we said, the roof wasn't $1 million, it's 500,000. We don't need to sell the rest of the money for that block. Let's say we get a big donation from the first benefactor. Sorry?
The Fremont people.
Or we have plenty of people in our Sunol community that might just say, hey, we want to donate to build a gymnasium or something. Of course, that would have to be approved. There's also a program with the state. It's gone now, the money's accounted for, but back when we had Measure O going, that we could get matching funds from the state. That could come up in the next few years. Okay, so, but we have to have the money in place first. So if we have, 10.9 million, we can say, hey, state, can you give us 5 million? And then we don't need to use our community's 5 million. I mean, these are all things that I see as options for us to not have to spend the whole 10.9 million.
So, well, again, part of the obligation is that the community has to have a bond oversight committee. I'd highly encourage you to be on there and to raise these concerns or whatever. And so, the architect is going to say what they're going to say. I don't remember. I know. I was at that meeting. I don't remember them saying that. But my interpretation of that was that he said, I thought he was meaning, this was 3 years ago. So, but I thought he was meaning like, that when you're in there, I picture it like your own house. Like, so you're sanding into the roof and then you get in there and you're like, oh my gosh, there's been all this water damage and now we have to do blah, blah, blah. But you have to go back to the committee and say, now we have to do, this other thing that when we opened it up, oh my gosh, we found this other piece. And the committee, it wasn't enumerated specifically on that list. The committee has to approve that. And then to Mike specifically ask that question that you're asking, like, what if we don't expense everything? Then our understanding was that there was a pathway for that as well. So, the board has similar concerns.
Yeah. But just so I'm clear, did I hear you say that you're asking for $10.9 million in a bucket somewhere? And the community says, all right, we're going to give you up to that. But as these bids come in for those specific items you've listed, if the seismic retrofit really did happen, and you don't need 3 million. Is the total of the bonds you're going to sell 7?
So there's our bond advisor. He's not saying, yep.
He's not high on that.
So that's his expertise. And the architects have their expertise, but the bond selling of the bonds is through the bond advisors, right? And so he has this very scenario with all the bonds they run. They run a lot of them in the state of California. Fortunately, this is how the state of California and their wisdom has decided that schools have to fund, which there's a whole issue about impoverished districts anyway. Yeah. You can go down a whole nother rabbit hole with that, but this is public education. And yet locally you have to raise taxes to fix your facilities. So, but like Mike said, there is something that Governor Newsom's talking about doing some sort of matching program that the state does provide. Cause I think LA, their schools are like literally falling apart. Yeah. I mean, our problems are not great, but it's bad in some of these other places. Are we out of time?
We have less than 6 minutes.
6 minutes and there's other.
Then maybe the question should be to the bond person. Is it a fact that if that bond issue passes, you're going to sell $10.9 million of the bonds come heck or high water?
No.
Okay.
Every bond sale, first off, and believe it or not, there is a school district that passed a bond and said, we're not going to sell any bonds. And they haven't, and it's been 15 years. But the way that this bond is structured is that you're not going to be able to do $11 million worth of improvements all at once. You can't displace all of the students. So you phase it in, right? It's like, okay, we're going to move all your kids over here, rent some portables, put you in there, and we're going to make these renovations. So there's right now 3 bond sales scheduled, just roughly $3.5 million, let's say. And each time you do a bond sale, we go to the board and say, hey, based on your tax base, within the confines of what we said, remember, we didn't want to increase the tax rate. So we're going to sell another series of bonds if you're ready. And then the board says, I can't spend the money or I don't need the money. So each sale is their choice as a board And then we sell the bonds on behalf of the district. They get the funds, they spend it. So you're in this scenario, there's three potential opportunities. Could be
put on the brakes, right?
Three different bond sales. Could be two, depending on what the district's needs are. But if they're in a situation where they say actual bids have come in, we don't need another $2 million, then you don't sell that $2 million.
And it doesn't go on the tax bill.
Wouldn't go on the tax bill, yeah.
Why not start with less? Why not start with 1 million?
1 million bond sale?
The 1 million.
So we're going to do a point of order.
Four minutes.
You need to fill out a card. Thank you.
But you have a card here, so.
You're next.
I just had a question. Yeah, I mean, I was throwing the question in there. Is it my turn or go ahead? Do you want to?
Not yet. I just have a couple more to ask.
No, answer
for Bob.
Whatever.
You said the board went stealth. And I'll tell you, after Measure O, I mean, okay, I came on the board 4 years ago, and I came to find out, wow, the school needs a lot of work. And my job is to, you know, make the best learning environment possible for the kids, specifically for the kids that live in Sonoma. And that meant, you know, renovating and restoring our old building. It meant it's all the stuff on the list. For me, I thought, what a great thing to have a multi-purpose room so that they could go inside and play. The public didn't want that. Okay, anyway, fast forward 2 years later, Measure O. I was a big proponent for it. Doesn't pass. I really took the wind out of my sails. I thought, man, I just thought with the last bond that we had in 1999, it was 87% support. We were good stewards with the money. We built exactly what we said we would. You know, people are accusing of like, oh, you know, you guys are crooked. You've got this pot of money. You're just going to do whatever you want with it. I mean, I just cannot believe that the people, you know, people who know me, they're not going to say that about me. I'm going to make sure that everything is done properly. We're not going to overspend. We're going to be as thrifty as possible. We're going to go for other sources of revenue. I'm like, I'm done. Yeah, I'll just finish my 2 years up. And then, okay, and then fast forward again to, okay, we have an election coming up. You know, this is my last chance to make sure that this school gets fixed up.
Yeah.
Let's go ahead and put it in. I mean, it was really like I was rushing to, actually, I think I had Ryan rush some papers to the office at the Registrar of Voters just to get them in time. So apologize for not a lot of communication, but we weren't even going to do it up until the last minute. So
I'll interrupt you for a second. Yeah. Nobody I have talked to who is for or against or anywhere has ever said that they thought you guys were crooked or sneaky or underhanded or thieves or pick whatever adjective you want.
I've heard it.
Yeah. Oh, you have? I'm sorry you did.
These people are volunteers and they care. They love, I'm going to get emotional. They love the school.
Yeah.
And they don't want it to, he's a fireman. He doesn't want to see it condemned.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, this is the way it is done in California. Pleasanton's going out for a $355 million bond. Livermore's going out for bond. They have a parcel tax. If our bond dies or our bond ends, that's fine. This town will have $0 going towards this school. And so it's disheartening.
But I don't think we'll.
But we support. I mean, it's a democratic process.
Yeah.
We
doesn't pass,
appreciate
we'll continue to find other ways to, you know, it's like, okay, let's have a fundraiser. We had some ideas from people in the audience. Let's get money to fix
it.
I think everybody could get behind that. But for me, my knowledge was this was the only way that I knew how to get such a large amount for the huge amount of just critical projects. Maybe I'm wrong. We'll let the public decide. You know. Okay. Are we
done? Thank you.
Okay.
About 30 seconds.
That item closes.
You know, so because I know I went low key. It was like breaking up with a boyfriend, not getting it. I really thought that we got it. It's like this school. I can't say enough wonderful things about this school. This school is amazing. And I think it's a flagship for Sonol. And that's why I mean, taking the wind out of my sail, that's exactly accurate. And I know it's like, but then, you know, you kind of like brush it off and go, you know, no, we can do this. We can do this. So, all right.
So that closes that agenda item. You can, the board can determine if to maybe ask some of the speakers if they would want to combine, and you can extend it by another like 5 minutes if you so determine.
Yeah. I'd like to let Debbie speak, and then maybe these other two, we can add to number 9 public comment.
Okay.
Yeah, because one came in after, which would be a number 9. So
we want to make sure everybody gets a chance.
We can have Linda Hurley talk on number 9.
Right.
It'll be 5 minutes.
Yeah, it'll be 5 minutes. Okay, go ahead, Debbie.
Okay, so it looks to me like grabbing low-hanging fruit, this huge pot of money. It's a lot of money for a very few people. And 22 million would cost an interest, rough and dirty. I don't have any exact numbers, among very few households. So, you know, everyone agrees that repairs are needed. I haven't heard anyone that doesn't. What I don't agree with is the overall cost that's being asked for. I don't see proper oversight or checks and balances. I don't see clear proposed use of the money. It seems open-ended. I don't agree that an architect should be driving this. I think an inspector should be coming in and doing a full and complete inspection of first talk about need, of what really needs to be done, and to get some estimates. The architect is the last person to start planning. We had an architect come in. I mean, they're drawing new things. I just don't see them being the ones at all. I'm very concerned about the way that people that are against the measure in its current form have been treated. It's been completely, you know, ridiculous, papering the downtown with yes signs, pulling down the no signs, calling people against it liars. Pardon me?
Point of order. Yes.
Disparaging us, bullying us, calling us names. It shows intent. It shows that there's a problem here. We're all equal in the community. With such a small community, this is just like you taking out a great big loan. You can't possibly compare it to other districts. And if you do compare it to Pleasanton, it would compare at $1 billion. So it's a small community, and there should be a committee of equal stakeholders. Let's talk about the inspection. Let's talk about the cost. Why not start with $1 million in a bond measure and use it for the must-haves, like let's say the roof or the wiring, and let everyone have equal input. So, I mean, that's what I want to see, is a divert. I want to see the bond measure changed and a diverse community to be able to have input and have proper oversight and look at the proper cost, not an endless pot of money to draw whenever you need, and to have other sources of money to get included in that as well.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
All right, I've taken a lot of notes on your comments, so thank you for having the courage to speak, everybody who spoke. And I'm going to let Linda Hurley and Tom Knutson talk on number 9, which is comments from the community, just because we ran out of time.
How many minutes each?
Three.
Yeah. We'll wait till
okay.
Item number 9. Okay. Item 8E, facilities maintenance report. Ms. Roxy.
Not a lot in report. Just been here with the usual fall. Definitely starting the quarterly pickup. So the other thing, we had a one air conditioner at 404. We had to replace the motor and it failed. We've got a major problem with the walk-in. Condenser was 63 years old, so we put a new condenser in, but now the compressor on the roof is having trouble sticking with that. We're working on it, trying to get this thing so it's up and running like a street. We had a cedar tree out here. We had to treat it for beetles. It's got a major infestation of beetles, and it's starting to take its toll, so we had an arborist come in. He's treated it, so hopefully get the beetle so it doesn't kill the tree, and then we've also fertilized it and watering and stuff. We've also got a couple other trees that have to fertilize and water a lot just because of the drought going on. So that's about it.
I just want to thank you, Mr. Hoxie. He is so on top of aware of these kinds of things. Like, a lot of people didn't realize that tree was calling out for help.
And it's a beloved, I mean, all of our trees are beloved and beautiful and have been here so long. So those are those kinds of things you want to jump on. And the 63-year-old refrigerator going out is alarming for us because that is, we do have to feed kids. And obviously we do get visits from the health people and that your refrigerator, the temperature and all those pieces have to be per code. But also Mr. Hoxie jumped on that as well. And we did get somebody that was able to come out. The problem with an older, beautiful refrigerator like that is that now the parts, it's hard to find the right parts and stuff. So if only we had. Just kidding. So, yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Hoxie.
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Hoxie, for just, again, being aware of all that and jumping on it.
Okay. Next item is AF technology report.
I would like to report to the board that we did have a new installation thanks to the grants that the district pursued during the pandemic from the SAC committee. We installed 3 TVs on the board, in the cafeteria, along with the speaker system, and we installed this 85-inch TV / computer for the community use. So I would like to thank the SAC committee for approving our grant and funding it. But besides that, we've been busy with supporting the teachers, going through our and. Pushing forward a couple of other projects in terms of technology through our pipeline and trying to get those done. And I believe Cammy has something.
I appreciate that. I'm sad Jerry left because this was part of the SAC committee. They did approve that bond for, that grant for us. And part of what he was saying when he was here is that they can't hold the SAC committee meetings live because the county wants there to be an access, like a hybrid. And so, I want to say thank Sean because he's been talking to the county IT person and explaining that we got this grant and we want to, we were able to upgrade some of our systems to be used for the community. And I think that they're in conversation. They still have some pieces that are unique to the SAC board meetings that they're going to want. So we'll be, continuing that conversation and communication. It's a great partnership to serve the school and the community. As well. So thank you for all your hard work on that.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sean.
Any
wrong. Yeah. So this is just my data and ed tech update. Coming soon is our Parent Square Communications. This is financially funded by our community club. This is basically our mass notification system for emergencies. The great thing about this Parent Square application, which ties into our student information system, so there's no duplication of data, it's all raw data that comes from our parents during enrollment registration, is that it includes multiple modalities, so voicemail, SMS text, email, and application notification for people who prefer an app. Don't want to put her on the hot seat, but Cheryl is here. She was in my test group, and maybe she could just comment a couple of words on what she thinks of it so far.
As a parent, yes. And we're at our test group and received that mass notification. How'd it go?
It was good. There was the alerts. We did some test alerts. We knew they were coming. And so you get it either, you can choose your phone, your text, or email, however you want to receive it. And then there's feedback back, be able to communicate back and forth. It was really great to be able to.
What's great for as a mass notification for an emergency situation, this allows the district to. So this provides our parents with the functionality to choose the modality that they prefer for more general, less emergency notices. But in a true emergency situation, the district can override that and broadcast an emergency message out to all modalities. So if there was a fire or an earthquake, something that was absolutely urgent, you broadcast your message out. And you can do that all from your phone. And I showed Cindy Grant today, all of those messages are pre-recorded. So we set all those up already. So there's no in the moment figuring out how do I make this message? What do I say? It's a kind of a boilerplate. So we have about 30 pre-recorded messages for various types of emergencies. And so this is just kind of our timeline for onboarding. We did our test group. We're moving into this week to office training. I sat down with Cindy today and had her send out a test message for a student who needed to be picked up in the front office. She really liked it because you can see, was it delivered? How did it get delivered? The parents were able to hear the message. And this was, what's really good about this is that today was a great test run because our parents speak a different language. It's their preferred household language. So this application will deliver it to them in their language automatically. Mm-hmm. So it does automatic translations. Mm-hmm.
Wow.
So just want a huge thank you to Community Club for funding this. I know it was something that has been, a lot of parents have been bringing up as a necessary need, especially when we have parents who work out of the area, right?
Mm-hmm.
They're kind of all over and they want to be able to make sure they can get here quickly and be informed.
Yeah, I think unfortunately the Beta Texas shooting was high on parents' minds, and because we have talked about this, but then when you look at a little tiny, you know, country little school that happened to, and what we've done in the past is we have, I think Cindy, our school secretary, is awesome, and our IT department is wonderful about sending out information, but mostly people received it on their email.
Yeah.
And then it became clear to us, not everybody is always looking at their email. I mean, you're shopping, you're picking up kids, whatever. And so this particular program, the availability for the user to decide, no, I want a text, or no, I do want an email, or I want both, or whatever. That was a huge selling point for us. And then again, we just really want to thank partnering with the Community Club, because it is a service for our parents. Our IT department and front office is supporting it as well. But it's so far with our test runs, it's gone really, really well. And I think people are very happy. So yes. You just have that little bit of a security blanket about it.
I got really great feedback from the parents who are in your test group and testing out with Cindy today, seeing her comfort level with using, you know, technology. There's always kinds of new things you have to learn, but she saw right away that it already ties into our database, which she uses on a daily basis. So I think for her, it was fantastic. She loved being able to have access to be able to put a blast out directly to a parent and kind of override if an emergency situation, I can make sure this gets to them. Next slide. Just wanted to point out I did create the Measure J informational website on the district webpage. So that request came in 9/13. The site was created and finalized on 9/14. So that was a very quick turnaround. It was quite fun. So thank you for everyone who submitted all the information and pieces to share out. Next slide, please. We are in the process of creating a new teacher FAQ guide. This is really helpful because, you know, we have a lot of teachers who have been here for a long time and they already kind of know how everything works. But when you're a new teacher coming in, or even a new staff person coming in, not knowing how do I log into the network? Where do I put in the support service ticket? Where do I, just a basic FAQ to kind of get them up and running. So we're launching that this week. And I think this really speaks to the district, which this is the first time we ever really ran into something like this, where we had somebody so new that, hey, they don't have this kind of historical information. Most of our staff here do, and I think that's because they didn't. Next slide, try one grading window. These are our key dates. You can see that right now we're in the middle of the report card modification. This is just gives our teachers, our standard-based grades from 2K through 5th, the ability to narrow down their standard-based grading strands. And is there anything that they want to modify or fine tune? And looking at report cards and you know, over the last couple of years, that we'll definitely see some changes there simply because we are all in person. So we don't have to accommodate anything that is a little bit, you know, more hybrid or online. That's not something we have right now. So you can see our grading window opens. They get quite a window of time to do those grades. And the reason why we leave our grading window open, you'll see at the very, very bottom, our district report cards become visible to our parents in parent portal on 11/14, but the grading window closes 11/18. That is the week they're doing parent-teacher conferences, and you might see some particular changes or better understanding come in from those parent-teacher conferences. So you might still see some revises happening to report cards, right? Some different comments coming in. So we do leave that open. Just want to point out that the district does provide digital report cards and that teachers, grade level teachers, have the option of printing and sending them home for their up to their discrepancy. So everyone has kind of a different lens on that for the classroom. And that is it for my report.
That Cardia's repurchased books, and we have books purchased for the library and classroom. So we really appreciate our families encouraging a love of reading in our students. Mrs. Bronze already covered it, but we had our 30th annual walkathon, and the theme was connecting together, and we raised almost, like you mentioned, $42,000. So that's fantastic. We really appreciate all our partners and donors. We did have a live in-person event on Friday, September 23rd, and we kicked it off with a fun activity that included the students themselves passing water over each other and getting wet to start off. And then we had some staff who were unknotting themselves. top individuals, the students who went around the track, we recorded about 40 laps. So around the track, they were kids who were continuously jogging around. I don't think they sprinted around, but they continued jogging around the track. And so a lot of students opted to stop, but we had fun stations with bubbles and tattoos. But the highlight was definitely the firefighters, which was unexpected. We walked over there, the firefighters were standing there, and they said they wanted in on the fun. So students picked up the squirt guns and were squirting them instead of the teachers who were supposed to be there. But the firefighters stayed there the whole entire event, and then made our event even better by hosing down the students, which we completely did not expect, and was a welcome surprise.
I have some pictures I should have given to you. Sorry, but if you want to look, it's just so cute. Mm-hmm.
So we will be celebrating our top individual end of this week and issuing thank you cards. Our budget for Thursday, most of our funds are going towards technology and then also support of our classrooms, our teachers, and our students. A couple of things that I wanted to mention. We've had garden days since August, and our students absolutely love going into the garden. And we've also had garden guests like a tortoise, not a little one, a huge tortoise,
yeah.
Who came and visited. The kids love petting and feeding. And this October 18th, next week, we'll have, don't want to spoil the surprise, but a king cobra and a tarantula. Just Ooh. In time for Halloween. And the kids will learn about the animals as well as do gardening. If anyone has any recycling, we would love to take that off your hands. So our amazing community has provided enough recycling that as of just the 2 months that we collected, we've already earned $400.
Wow.
Yeah, so that's amazing.
Plastic bottles or just cans?
Yeah, plastic bottles and aluminum cans. No glass bottles. Those are too heavy and they don't run into them. Just plastic recycled bottles and cans.
And when are you collecting them?
We usually do it the last Friday of every month.
Last Friday, so. Here.
Yes, at the school, so you can stop by the parking lot. We'll try
to. I'll email you.
Yeah.
It's like, it's such a great fundraiser. You get rid of your things and then the school gets money. It's done amazingly.
Right. We usually raise about $1,000 a year just on recyclables that would go in the garbage, mm-hmm. but instead are then the funds get. Turned back and used for our students. We do have a STEAM event that is planned for Friday, November 11th, and that's sponsored by CDM Smith. It's an engineering company that's associated with the Sunil Water Temple. And so plans are in the works for this fabulous event, and we're looking to hold it on the school ground on November 11th. So we should have more news on that next month. The last things we're doing is planning assisting the science camp, sixth grade science camp with their fundraisers. And we're doing pies. So if you need pies for the holiday season, then
we'll email that to you.
Information will be coming out on getting pies.
Or you have to plastic bottle one.
Tell Cindy.
No, that you're on your own for that. Sorry. Well, they're little. Does that count? They are little. They're so good though.
All I have for it.
Thanks a lot. Hey Cheryl, what time and location for the meet, the community club meeting?
It'll be this Thursday. We're gonna have it at the Snow Park right by the
Woodbury.
Yeah, Woodbury.
Just like after drop off. Thank you. That's the report. Okay, Dry Valley Sump report.
Nothing to report. A lot. I did go to the meeting. They are they really wanted to look at what the state is recognizing as a huge increase in special ed needs, and as in particularly ERMs, which is for the emotionally needy children, that they've seen this. And we think it's connected to the pandemic, learning loss when kids were at home for 2 years, and then the anxiety, depression, and self-harming there's just been a huge uptick. So it's a huge concern. So there's federal and state monies that are going to be specifically geared towards those kinds of supports for our students, which is needed. So we're looking at that.
And will they even do in-person meetings from now forward?
Self-ed, I think their plan is to meet in person now, which is kind of nice. Although you have to drive over there. They're held at Pleasanton.
Okay, number 9 is community comments from the community. So we carried over a couple speakers for that. Linda Hurley, you're up first.
Yeah, okay. How many minutes?
3 minutes. Go ahead.
So hot. Okay, so questions from people have come to me. Are we complete this year on the last bond? I'm hearing from 2 people, they say not until 2024. Okay, that's one question. Is there any money left from the last bond measure? Is there anything still in the kitty? And numbers attached. Okay, you already answered that one. So the numbers that you had for each project broken down was from this architect. Is that correct? Okay, so why are they no longer on the website? They weren't today on the website. They've taken off, and all you have is the $10,900,000. And then another thing came to my attention, that they have back to look to see if this was accurate. So in June, which meeting I did not come to, I've been to August, September. At any rate, you had a speaker named Dawn, and I couldn't make out her last name entirely. Started with an R, last name. And she said that you were gonna get unrestricted $375,000 from Governor Newsom. Okay.
I think she said approximately. Yeah.
Right, I get it. So if your enrollment's gone down, so it may be slightly less. I don't know, but it sounded like it was based upon your ADA, or each child you got 15,000. So I'm just wondering how you plan to spend that, since there's unrestriction to it, and if that can't be used, it sounds like it could come close to taking care of the roof. I mean, you may have more. I know when you rip off a roof that you find more damage than you thought there'd be, but okay. And all right, then this is a comment. These were questions. This comment has to do with the last bond that passed 25 years ago. Very different scenario. The public, you know, Mr. Schimmel started at least a year. Okay, I guess my time's up.
No, 1 minute. This is a warning.
Yeah, we won't be able to answer any, but
go ahead. So, he knew his audience, and he came to us with his vision and sat down with a lot of different people in the community. I don't recall if we actually had a committee, but he asked. I know we started the community club on 5 or 6 parents, mothers that got together, and we started that. So what I'm saying is that the divisiveness that's happened with this, the nastiness of people coming at one another over this bond, I really believe could have been completely eliminated if it had been done differently. Get a committee that encompasses all groups of people, you know, your liberal and your redneck farmers and what have you, sit down and all, you know, go at it together. And I think it would have been much smoother. I think better chance of passing.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, we did have numerous meetings at the SAC board, and we actually pounded the pavement before. We actually invited we had a huge meeting with, and we asked stakeholders like Ario and some of the other people, Jim O'Loughlin, to bring some of their people with their varying views. So those meetings did take place. It's really hard to get a hold of everybody. We've had meetings in the park. We agree. Hard. It has been disheartening, the divisiveness. To me, this is what makes a democracy, is people can vote no, people can vote yes. I mean, you don't have to vilify either side. People feel passionately about why they want to vote no, and people feel passionately about why they want to vote yes. But to me, I mean, this is my personal, I just feel
there
like
are boundaries.
I prefer people to be respectful. It broke my heart that people, no, I mean, you know me, Bob knows me. You know, I'm speaking from my heart. I don't want to vilify anybody. It breaks my heart that I don't even know you, Debbie, that you're saying that people have made you feel that way. Horrible names. That is not okay. And that's not this an old community that I've grown to love and know. So we constantly feel this elusiveness of getting the word out. And we feel like we've tried, but you know, we always know we need to relook at it and try even harder. But I want to reassure you, we have tried, and those different people were invited. Not all 500 or about 890 vote people that live here. Just we tried to get the word out. And then I know we're out of time. The 350,000, we did 375. That was an approximation that was a little premature. She was basing that on what the governor was saying he was wanting to do per ADA. It got down water, but that was in June. By July, when the budget got passed by the state, music and discretionary fund block. Okay. So it does have that word discretionary, which has been a little misleading, because I looked it up specifically to see what discretionary meant. It isn't. You can't do the roof. It's art, music, and instructional materials. And it's our discretion how we then use that. And it's 100.
Why did she say it was unrestricted?
I don't know.
Because she said it twice.
I don't know. She was a consultant that was hired by the county, and I asked her about that. She no longer is there. It's $168,000.
I do have a screenshot of that bond, and it says there is intent language. That this funding be used to address student learning challenges, protect staff levels, and support the mental health and wellness of students and staff. It says it's important to remember that the intent language does not have the force of law. So we could, I guess, choose to follow the intent language, or we can choose to do the roof, you know, or whatever. But we don't have the money yet, so.
And it's what was actually, by the time the state passed it, it's 106, it is per ADA, and it's like $168,707. We looked it up, and now I'm sorry, it was nowhere near, it was a little disheartening. It was nowhere near 375. You know, it was premature for her to put that slide in. She's a consultant, that's what she wanted to do. Mm-hmm. We've never even had a slideshow like that before. She was great. She came from a huge district, She came from a huge district, so maybe that was their protocol. But anyway, I wanted to make sure.
And I've written down your other questions, so
okay. We're good. I know we're way out of time, but thank you.
Tom Newton.
Thanks.
I'll give you a 1 minute warning. Nice to know. So that's a
I may be a little bit late to the party, but it seems that if possible, a further town hall meeting of something would be beneficial. We do have people here that oppose the bond, and there are obviously people that support it. A presentation by either side with the actual facts. I mean, some things were cleared up today about the bond. You know, if you don't spend it, you know, do you only go for $7 million in bond? I think an opportunity for those folk for and against to make their case would be beneficial to the community. And I don't know if that's possible, Mike. I heard you try to set that up before, but I would urge the no people and the yes people to make their case, and let's see.
And let the voters say. Yeah. I think so. We were at the SAC board committee, so we feel like that is your town hall. That is your, you know, we're unincorporated, so we don't have a mayor and, you know, Summer Bosco. We don't have, you know, an official town hall, but the SAC. Those are people that sort of work on that. And I think you were there. We were at the last SAC board meeting trying to get the word out. The no people are well, you know, they're welcome. SAC board meeting is a public meeting, so they
can come. The next meeting is October 19th, 6:30 p.m. We're going to be on the agenda, so everybody's welcome to fill out a card and speak.
That's all still Zoom stuff.
That's another question. What the last meeting was Zoom, but I don't know if the next one they're going to have it.
They said that I think the next one they're not ready for. We told them you're welcome. We felt like we had enough bandwidth and everything, but whatever their rubrics are from the county, they wanted the live meetings to be held in. Who were there? They said like Castor Valley. That is not serving the town. They're not going to drive to Castor Valley for their own town meeting when they can be right here at the school. But anyway,
septic people have it up there, so
they do.
Yeah, that way nobody can go.
Well, see, that's how it feels. It feels unwelcoming. So I tried. I opened that. I said, come to the school. We'll figure it out.
For whatever this is worth, and I don't mean to interrupt here, but when the school was rebuilt in the configuration that it is now, there was an incredible amount of time spent with community meetings. There was back and forth. There was a component that wanted bricks and sticks. They wanted they wanted all the buildings to be permanent. I was on the side that pushed for the modulars with some fancy stuff to the front of them. But the community was very, very engaged in that. And it seems like it went on a long, everything in this town takes a long, long
time. Like the light colors of the light bulb?
Yeah, everything takes a long, seriously.
I know.
There's a number of folks on that thing, but it, depending on what happens in November, that may be a path forward or backwards or whatever it is. My wife was very, very, very involved in that. So I can ask her how the committee was put together, where it came from.
Was she a mom? Was she a parent?
Cindy, my mom, yeah.
Yes.
No, my mom, my wife, my daughter.
What you meant.
Yeah, my daughter is probably just out of grade school.
Yeah. So I do think that there has been a shift in, I'm speaking as an old person, a grandma here. I do think there's a shift in the styling of parents, because it did kind of throw me. So my kids were, it was about the same time that you guys were going for your bond here. We were going for our neighbor. I was like, I'll call, I'll walk, I'll do all this stuff, because my kids, you know, it was going to affect their schools. And our parents here, they love to do garden and they love to do walkathon. We did hold a meeting. We went to the parents club because we did feel like parent voices, you know, are really important, and they are totally for the bond. And then it was like, hey, do you want to walk the pavement? We set this whole thing, and it was the three board members, the former superintendent, myself, Connie DeGrange, who was a big, she's been super helpful. This is what we did in 1999. And she was kind of surprised because it was a parent. And I love our parents, as you hear, are wonderful, but they have a different lens, I feel, than it was back. That's just my opinion. It kind of threw me for a surprise. And I'm talking even as a mom myself in my community, like it was all moms and dads. You know, we were the ones knocking door to door and making the phone call. So I know we're way over time.
What's that meeting you were talking about tomorrow night, by the way?
Tomorrow?
Mike,
I'll talk to you later.
That's not something to announce to everyone here? Is that like a town hall? Or
I was just going to invite the know people, so you guys could talk to me.
I thought it was for the whole community. Oh, it's not for the whole community.
It's the CTC of the staff board.
Will it be cold tar?
Tomorrow. Let's talk about tomorrow night.
Yeah.
I thought it was for the whole community, like a town hall.
Can be, but that, I got a request from somebody that didn't want to be attacked. So I thought, you know, let me just have the know people come, and you know, I can take a bunch of notes and bring it back to the board. You know,
you should be able to just sit and talk, right?
Well,
it's kind of late in the day.
Yeah,
this should have happened months ago.
Yep,
really right.
And I've already given so many. I've given a billion comments, and they really don't matter, because whatever I say, it just goes out with the wash. I mean, I think the bond should be much less money and much more targeted. And then if you need more money, ask for another bond and get everybody involved and included in this discussion from all different opinions, instead of let's pay it as much as we can. And then if we don't need it, we'll give it back. That's backwards. And an architect, no, those guys are always overpriced and they just look at the big picture.
All right. Thank you. We're going to move on to number 10. If anybody doesn't want to stay for this boring business stuff, you can leave. Otherwise, you'll have to stay.
If it won't hurt your feelings, I'll go. Okay. Thank you all for listening to me.
No, we appreciate you coming. Thank you.
We appreciate everybody coming.
Thank you.
Yes, you forgot your water.
And Kelly.
I'll take the info on the bottles because we go through a lot of plastic bottles.
Okay.
Thank you. A little bit help me get through the.
There's one right there.
Yeah, this was not mine. This was Cindy's. I'm gonna here. You guys can.
Just, yeah, well, there's one.
It'll be right there.
There's one for us.
Thank you. Number 10A is report discussion of possible action regarding the approval of resolution number 22-2023-09, increasing school facilities fees as authorized by government code section 65995B3. Make a motion to approve.
I second.
Any discussion?
No.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. 10B, report discussion of possible, we actually moved that up, so we'll skip that. We're on to number 11, consent items. We'll just lump these all together, 11A through E. The only comment I have is the minutes. Time said started at 7 p.m. We should have 5
p.m. Oh. It felt like it was 5.
Yeah, but anyway, just made that change, and I move to approve all these consent items with that change. Any discussions?
Nope.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay.
For number 12, it's our calendar. November, we have no meeting. December 13th is our next meeting. Will we find out who our new board will be?
Changing of the guards.
Changing of the guards.
January 10th, February 7th. Close some comments. I just want to thank everybody for coming, expressing your concerns. I have a lot of questions to answer and information to pass out. Thanks for being here, Chris, representing.
Yeah.
Teresa's not going to be here representing anymore.
Oh, no. Oh, yeah. Oh.
Oh.
I thought you were just here with IT.
She's doing both support.
Yeah.
Okay. She's our new CSEA president.
Well, we welcome you.
And Liz is your last full meeting.
December, welcome to the board, but thank you.
Thank you.
Appreciate it very much. So in that statement, we're going to.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.